Shabbat Shalom, Havarim.
Shabbat Shalom.
As we begin today, I want to ask you to pick up your scriptures. I'm going to share something with you right out of the scriptures here before we even get started. I want to read it to you, but I want you to see it in your own scriptures. And so if you would open to Jeremiah, the 16th chapter. I'm going to read from the scriptures that I'm holding in my hand. Before I do, though, I want to say this to you. Are we all aware of the fact that Israel, from day one until today, are very guilty of not obeying Yahweh and not following Him? And are you also aware that the tendency is always to blame something or someone else other than ourselves? And so before I even go into what I'm going to be sharing with you today, look at verse 19 of Jeremiah chapter 16. And read along with me. I want to see if your version reads just like mine does. O Yahweh, my strength and my stronghold, and my refuge in the day of distress. To you the nations will come from the ends of the earth and say, our fathers inherited the lies of the previous administration. Of course, I'm joking, and you get the joke. But he says, our fathers inherited nothing but falsehood, futility, and things of no profit. Now, why did I bring that up, and why am I trying to be cute and funny? I'm not. I'm simply saying this. If we inherited something from someone else, does it not behoove us to turn and go back to the truth and teach it the way that it should be instead of continuing? It's very easy to say, well, I inherited all this mess. Well, great. What have you done about it since you inherited it? My point is this. Israel inherited a mess from their forefathers. What did they do with it? Nothing. They passed it on to us. We pass it on to our children. And so it just continues in a vicious circle. And when is it going to stop? Today I want to talk about Judah and Israel at the end. And the reason I want to is because whether we really understand it or not, we are so close to the end. And it was amazing to me that in Jeremiah chapter 4, he shares with us what it's going to be like in the end times, particularly when the forces of the 200 million man army that's spoken of begins to march toward Jerusalem, toward the capital of Israel, and to see what Yahweh says has taken us from being again the choice vine, which we taught last week, into being something that was detestable. So look at Jeremiah 4:1. He begins the dialogue with us. I want you to understand this is with us. How many in the room here understand when we read from the Torah and we read what happened to Israel back then, how many of you understand it's not a history lesson? Yahweh is not trying to teach you a history lesson. What He is trying to teach you is what Shaul says in 1 Corinthians, when Shaul says that those things that happened to Israel then are for us as an example, for us who live in the end times. He's not interested in teaching you a history lesson. He's interested in you seeing the mistakes that were made by your forefathers and my forefathers, and how we should correct that in the direction that we ought to go. He says, if you return, O Israel, declares Yahweh, to me you should return. Now, there's an interesting point in that. Why do you think he's pointing out specifically? He's saying, it's to me that you should return. But who did they return to? Their idols, their high places, their Ashtaroth, and all of those kinds of things. He says, if you remove your detestable things from my presence and do not waver. So all of us in this room, excuse my voice today, all of us in this room know that the Hebrew for return is shub. Shub. Shub is an action word which means to turn. But you hear it often taught again that it simply means turn and go a different direction. Anybody ever hear that? But that is not what it means. Shub does not mean go a different direction. It's very specific in what it means. It is to turn back to a previous state or place, to return. How many of you ever thought about the word return? We just casually say it, return. But it means to return, to go back to where you started. In this case, he says, if you return to me, O Israel. How can we return to him, beloved? By going back to the Torah. Going back and looking at his teachings, his instructions, his words for us. And start living by them. Start doing what it says to do. His instructions are not out there as suggestions. His teachings to us are not optional. If he tells us to do something, do them. Because that is what he expects us to do. If you will note, he says, to me you shall return. I can't think of a better source to return to. And his word is him. Does everybody agree with me there? He is the word, and the word is him.
Amen.
He says, if you will remove your detestable things, shikuts, a sheen, a kuf, and a zadi, a dirty, detestable thing. Why do we want to put before our Father, our Abba, something that is dirty, something that is detestable, when he is all about those things that are clean? Amen? And why do we have that responsibility? Because we're priests. We're supposed to differentiate between the clean and the unclean, aren't we? So why do we put something that's dirty before him? How do we make things dirty? I'll just put some examples. Walking out of the boundary of the Torah. Everything that is within the boundary of the Torah should be clean, acceptable to Yahweh. If we walk outside of that boundary of the Torah, it isn't his choice, it's our choice. And when we choose to walk outside of the boundary, and we get out there, out from under the cover of his protection, why is it we point our finger at him and blame him? When we chose to walk outside that Torah boundary, did we not? And so we can never point the blame at him. Because hear me out, when you walk outside the boundary of the Torah, you take yourself out from under his cover of protection. He has no responsibility for you when you're living outside of the Torah. Number two, get rid of the idols. Well, I would guarantee you, if I ask most believers today who are faithful churchgoers, have you removed all of the idols out of your life? What do you think most of them, if not all of them, would say? Yes, absolutely. I don't have any idols. Oh, really? Do you think that's true, that they don't have?
No.
They have several idols. Now, listen, if you're out there listening on the internet, saying, that guy don't know what he's talking about, believe me, I do know, because I was a pastor for 13 years as a Southern Baptist. I realize now that I had idols in my life. And I'll just name you a couple of them. Christmas and Easter are idols. Remain faithful. Yesterday, when we were meeting with Joseph and his wife, Sarah, the subject of faith came up three times. And I was amazed that he looks at faith just like we do. How many of us in this room know that you cannot get saved unless He gives you the faith to get saved? We don't even have enough faith ability on our own to even receive the offering of salvation. He has to give us a measure of faith in order for us to accept that. And Joseph realized in the conversations yesterday that faith is something you do, not something you just conjure up and believe. And so these things are very important. Don't walk outside of the boundaries of Torah. Get the idols out of your life and remain faithful to Yahweh. Begin to do things, not just look pretty, not just say, well, I believe this or I believe that, but let people know out there that you believe this by the way you live it, by how you walk it out, not how you talk it out. Talk is cheap, right? Number four, return to the Torah lifestyle. If you have walked outside of the boundaries of Torah, return and get back home. Get back in the safety of the Torah. And then you'll begin to see life become a little better for you, a whole lot better for you, right? It's only when Israel walks outside the Torah that things begin to happen that are not good. And we'll see that today. And also we'll see in the teaching today how Yahweh feels about our excuses. Verse 2. And if you swear as Yahweh lives in truth, in justice, and in righteousness, then nations shall bless themselves in Him, and in Him they shall glory. Swear, Shabbat. Shabbat, made up of a Shin, Bet, and Ayin. But listen to this. It means to make an oath seven times. Because Shabbat comes from the root word seven in Hebrew. So when you made an oath, you made it seven times. Why seven times? Because that's Yahweh's perfection, His perfected number, right? Seven is the word Sheba. It is formed with the same parent root as you see Shabbat. Just the way it's pronounced is a little bit different. Other than that, it's the same word, if you would. The oath must consist of three things, according to Yahweh, that you just saw in that verse. And see, this is why I'm telling you that it's important to have your scriptures open in front of you so you can look at these verses as I'm talking about them. Otherwise, you get lost. The oath must consist of three things from the verse that I just gave you. Let's look. First of all, he says it has to be emet. It has to be truth. Truth, meaning truth, trustworthiness, faithfulness, certainty, and stability. So truth encompasses all of those things. Number two, mishpat. Mishpat. Verdict according to the Torah. When Yahweh judges, does he judge outside of the Torah?
No.
Or does he use his own Torah to judge? He's put the law there, and he judges according to that. And he'll never make a verdict outside of that, will he? Tzedakah. Judge in justice, righteousness, and with virtue. So the three things that the oath has to have. First of all, it has to be truthful. Secondly, it has to be according to the Torah. You can't make an oath outside the Torah, in other words. And then it has to be righteous. It has to be just. And it has to be virtuous. Otherwise, it's not an oath. What happens when these are violated? What happens when we violate emet or tzedakah or mishpat? What happens when those things are violated? Number one, men are deceived. That's why, beloved people, there are so many people today who are deceived because these things are, oaths are made outside of those parameters. Nations are not blessed. If we're making oaths and trying to guarantee something, and it's outside of the Torah, don't expect it to happen. And what happens when it doesn't happen? Then the nations are not blessed. Number three, men do not have a reason to celebrate. Do we have reason to celebrate?
Absolutely.
All of our feasts and festivals are about celebration. Okay? But have you noticed that in spite of everything that we talk about year after year, for instance, at Sukkot, we do really good, okay? I'm not slamming us, but there's always this element of complaining at Sukkot. There should not be one complaint expressed in Sukkot. It should all be praise and worship, right? Instead of complaining. But it's inevitable that it always happens. And I've been guilty myself. Jeremiah 4, verse 3. For thus says Yahweh to the men of Judah and Jerusalem, break up your fallow ground and sow not among thorns. Now, do you understand when I said that this is to tell us how we should not do things? Don't do as they do. Do what the Torah says do. So here he's talking to us. Break up fallow ground. In other words, till the ground which you have plowed. Fallow ground means ground that has been plowed. But how many in the room here know that you don't plant seed in plowed ground? You till the ground. You ever see them go out there with a tiller after they plowed the ground? Then you make the rows, plant the seed, and do whatever else you're going to do. Susan would know all about that in her garden. Plowed ground is plowed ground. It's big chunks when it's plowed, right? Thorns. This is interesting because he says, don't plant your seed among the thorns. Now, what are the seed? It's the word. It isn't how much money you're going to send to some bogus ministry. It's about how you are going to give the word and share the word, the Torah. It is a word there, quotes, and it means thorn. Now, what's important about what he says here? Don't plant among the thorn. What is the purpose of the thorns?
To choke out the good seed.
They choke out the word, don't they? Israel is told not to sow, that is zarah, to plant, to conceive seed among thorns. Thorns and tares speak of the restrainer, that which holds back the wheat. So, if I sow seed among the thorns or the tares, it's going to restrain the produce, the wheat. And so the word isn't going to get out there. We naturally think of the anti-Messiah as being the restrainer, right? However, there are many things today that restrain the wheat. Recreation. I would rather play golf than to go to worship service today, than to go to the synagogue today, to go to the shul today. I'd rather learn about golf than to learn about Torah. And so, recreation takes away the word. Second, families. This is a big one. Folks, we can let our family restrain us from keeping the Torah. And I would say that that's one of the top 10, is letting families prevent you from doing what you know you should do. Money. Money is another one that gets in the way. Money is a restrainer. It can be a tremendous blessing, but it can also be a restrainer. In other words, there's many, many businesses today that are open today and making money rather than keeping the commandment to keep the Sabbath. Right? Nothing wrong with making money, but it's how you do it. And others. There's many other ways, right? Kind of reminds me, my wife and I and Mary usually go about quite a bit down to Golden Corral on 3500. And as we're coming back home, there's a pet shop on the right that I've always told Mary I want to go in there and figure out what it is. Kind of like these and others. Has a big sign outside on the front. It says pets and such. And I've always wanted to go in there and see if I could buy a such. I want to go in there and say, you have pets, but what is a such? What are pets and such? And so, and others. You can think of probably a lot of others that restrain us from keeping the Torah. There's many, many of them out there. Circumcise yourselves to Yahweh. Remove the foreskins of your hearts. O men of Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem, lest my wrath go forth like fire and burn with none to quench it, because of the evil of your deeds. Physical circumcision was a shadow picture again of a heart circumcision. Do you understand again that it's the natural first and then the spiritual? So how does he teach us about the spiritual? By showing us the natural. So the removing of the flesh in physical circumcision is a picture of removing the flesh from the heart and circumcising the heart. 1 Corinthians 15:46 says, but it is not the spiritual that is first, but the natural, and then the spiritual. And that's what I just tried to convey to you in the statement that I just made. Yahweh teaches us the spiritual by showing us the natural. The thing that we can sense with our five senses is set out there to teach us about the things we cannot sense with our senses. And so, he is absolutely wonderful in that regard. From this passage, it becomes clear that Yahweh's wrath is poured out on all who have uncircumcised hearts. Now, you can be physically circumcised, but if you don't have a circumcised heart, then his wrath is poured out. Physical circumcision is supposed to be a sign, is it not, of a covenant that he made with Abraham and himself, which was what? A covenant of salvation. A lot of people would look at that covenant and they would say, well, the covenant was really about land. He made a covenant to give Abraham some land. But what did he do when he walked between those pieces? He gave a covenant of sacrifice, a covenant of salvation. And that is what we inherit. Declare in Judah and proclaim in Jerusalem and say, blow the trumpet through the land. Cry aloud and say, assemble, and let us go into the fortified cities. Raise a value system. Is that what it says?
Standard.
Raise a standard toward Zion. Flee for safety. Stay not, for I bring disaster from the north and great destruction. That, beloved people, is a warning to us. Because Israel didn't pay much attention when Titus came and destroyed the temple in 70 AD. You know what the tendency is to sit back and say, well, I don't have to worry about that because God's going to do that for me. I don't have to worry about that because Jesus did that for me. He put a brain in our head and a heart in our chest. And that is to serve Him and to study the Torah and know what the Torah says and prepare ourselves for what's coming down. Because everybody on this planet is not righteous. Does everybody know that? There are people out there who want to kill you and want to kill me. And they won't hesitate to do that. Because they believe in their heart that they're serving their God. And so we have to learn from the Torah what to expect, what's coming down the pike, and know how to stay alive and how to avoid disaster. A foretelling of the great armies which will march against modern Israel. Here Israel is told to do five things in that passage that I just read. So let's look at them. One, he says, sound the shofar throughout the land. Sound the shofar and warn Israel that disaster is coming. There is a great cloud that is descending upon us from the north. Warn people, let people know. Number two, shout out the warning to leave Jerusalem. If you are a tiny nation, as Israel is in the land, and you've got a 200 million man army barnstorming you, it's time to get out of Dodge. Does everybody understand that? Why doesn't he just say here, just trust in me, I'll take care of you? He says, get out, doesn't he? That doesn't mean he isn't going to stand in the gap for you and defend you. But he says, don't be a sacrifice and stay there like a dummy because I'm telling you to leave. But we want to argue with him. Raise the standard. Give a signal. Let people know what's coming. How can we give a signal today? Somebody help me. How can I give a signal to let everybody know there's a 200 million man army coming? I teach them. I raise the standard of the Torah. And I say, this is the word of the Creator of the universe. Pay attention. It's going to happen. It is His determined will. He's not playing games here. Number four, run! Run for safety. Folks, this is Elohim telling us this. He also tells us someplace else over in the Brit Hadasha, flee from Satan. Right? Get out of the danger areas. They are safe havens. Do you remember? He put safe havens here and there throughout the land. Will his warning be any less for those in the end days? He just gave them warnings. What about us? Do we say, well, that's just a history lesson. I don't need to pay attention to that. Or do we get serious about this and say, this is something that's coming. This is coming down the pike. Is it supposed to fill us with fear and cause us to shake and tremble? It's calling upon us to have the fear of Elohim and use common sense and follow Him. And He will take care of us if we do. Verse 7, a lion has gone up from his thicket, a destroyer of nations has set out. He has gone from his place to make your land a waste. Your cities will be ruins without inhabitant. What has he just told us? That people are going to be out of the city, right? We don't live in Jerusalem right now. But we live in a city, don't we? All of us live in a city. So the way I look at it, back then he was talking about Jerusalem, but back then they weren't scattered all over the face of the earth. Today we are, and we live in a city. Get out of the city. Lion. A lion has gone up. This word is Ai. Ai. And it's a concrete word meaning lion. The abstract meaning is fear, though. A feared animal. And so, a feared animal. Something that instills fear. Do you believe that the Adamessiah will instill fear in people?
Sure.
But if you think he's going to instill fear in you, just wait until the wrath of the Almighty falls.
Absolutely.
I hear the murmurings of fear even now among those who claim to be Torah observant. Yahweh did not give you a spirit of fear. What I mean by that, we've actually had people leave our congregation because they believed in a rapture. And when I taught them that there was no such thing as that, they just couldn't abide by that. They said, I just can't think of going through that. And so their fear of the enemy is greater than their fear of Yahweh. And they think, well, if I just run away from it, it won't happen. What a sad mistake to make. Because we'll see that Israel did that same thing. Right? So, if Yahweh don't give you a spirit of fear, where does that fear come from?
The enemy
rises up in you. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, for Eloah gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Now, I'm going to get in on Jim's bandwagon right now and stand up on my box here and tell you, I'm sick to death of hearing Christian people who say God is in control. The Holy Spirit is in control. He just said there that He gave you a spirit of love and self-control. Didn't He? You make the choices. He doesn't. He says, I place before you choices. You choose. And so what do? We make the choice. And it is rather we allow Him to be in control of things that happen in our lives. And how do we judge that? By living according to what He teaches us. His instructions that He tells us. My wife just pointed out, notice it says, but of power. What is that power? The Ruach HaKodesh that He puts in you grants you the power to have self-control. See? And that's the whole idea. He doesn't leave you just empty and say, well, you take care of it, you control it. He gives you the power to be able to do that through the Ruach who is living in you. Otherwise, we couldn't have self-control. But it's a mistake to think that He controls every aspect of your life. He does not. He gives you the power through the Ruach for you to be in control. And that's a cop-out if you have something happen in your life, you say, well, I thought He was in control. Well, you're supposed to be. You're supposed to be making the choices. Verse 4, 8, and following. For this put on sackcloth, lament and wail, for the fierce anger of Yahweh has not turned back from us. In that day, declares Yahweh, courage shall fail both king and officials. The priest shall be appalled and the prophets astounded. Then I said, Ah, Master Elohim, surely... Now listen carefully to this. You need to get this. You have utterly deceived this people at Jerusalem, saying it will be well with you, whereas the sword has reached their very life. Now I want you to hear this because this is Yirmiyahu. Jeremiah. And what did he just say? You, Master Elohim, have deceived this people in Jerusalem. This is the prophet. Did he deceive Jerusalem and the people?
They're blaming him, but he didn't.
This is what I want you to see. This is called the blame game. What is wrong with these verses? Do we really believe that Yahweh told the people that they could live as they pleased and all would be well? I stand up here week after week and teach the Torah and tell you that Yahweh gives you clear warning before He takes any action whatsoever. He gives us all time to return to Shub, to turn back to Him. Had Yahweh deceived them? What do you think?
No.
Does Yahweh ever deceive anybody?
No.
Where did the deception come from?
The enemy.
Mm.
The enemy, just like in the garden.
Do you know the difference between temptation and testing? Mm-hmm. Temptation is on the outside when HaSatan tempts you to transgress the Torah. Yahweh always tests you on the inside. So where is it coming from? Outside or inside?
Outside.
Jeremiah 4:11 and 12. At that time it will be said to this people and to Jerusalem, a hot wind from bare heights in the desert toward the daughter of my people, not to winnow or cleanse. A wind too full for this comes for me. Now it is I who speak in judgment upon them. Not a cleansing, purifying wind. In other words, not the Ruach. Mm-hmm. But another wind is coming.
Wind judgment.
Hot wind. Zach. In this word picture, we see a Zadi representing a man on his side, meaning trouble. Does everybody see that? That's this one right there. That's a man laying on his side, meaning trouble. The Het represents a wall that separates, and combined they mean trouble outside. And so the concrete meaning is a desert. So when we see hot wind up there, what is it talking about? It's not talking about the Ruach. It's talking about a judgment that's coming. Okay? Bare heights. He mentioned bare heights. Shefi, a sheen, pei, and a yod. The word picture is the sheen. Let's see if I can point these out. That's a sheen. I don't know if you can see that on the internet. That's a sheen. A pei, which is the second one right here, and a yod right there. The sheen is teeth. The pay means a mouth. When combined, they mean sharp teeth in the mouth. And the meaning is high place. High place then means a serpent lifting his head to strike.
Oh.
Who is the serpent?
Hasatan.
So Hasatan is coiled and lifting his head, ready to strike. This is what he's trying to tell us is coming. Trouble was headed for Jerusalem, and trouble is headed for Jerusalem.
Yes.
Have you listened to Prime Minister Netanyahu lately? He is getting more and more troubled about the Iranian situation. Today, as I was watching the news just before I came over here, Iran just released information this morning that they have a missile now that will strike 128 miles away. And they are saying they can hit with precision. And they're targeting all American holdings within that range, as well as Israel. It is as though a serpent is about to strike, and the wind is not to sift or cleanse. It's a judgment sweeping over the land. Jeremiah 4:13. Behold, he comes up like clouds, his chariots like the whirlwind, his horses are swifter than eagles. Woe to us, for we are ruined. This is the voice sounds like unrepentant people. O Jerusalem, wash your heart from evil that you might be saved. How long shall your wicked thoughts lodge within you? Saved. We've talked about this many times. Yasha. The word yasha in Hebrew means to rescue. Essentially rescue. To protect. Israel has been turning to idolatry for thousands of years. They do it without always recognizing it. I mentioned some earlier about idols. Who would have thought that Christmas and Easter were idols? It hadn't been too many years ago that you would have had a hard time convincing me that Christmas and Easter were idolatry. Although I fully understand today that they are. But back when I was in that system, you'd had a hard time convincing me. How long will it take to turn from false doctrine and get back to the Torah? When are we going to wake up? The one thing that we had a discussion yesterday again when we were over at this gentleman's house about what is it going to take? It's going to take a penetration of truth into these minds and hearts of these people to realize that these things are not of Yahweh and to get back to the truth, to turn their hearts away from those kind of things. Jeremiah 4:15, for a voice declares from Dan and proclaims trouble from Mount Ephraim. Why does he mention Dan and Ephraim? Because they are north. From Dan, the northern boundary of Palestine, from Mount Ephraim, the northern boundary of the king of Judah, not far distant from Jerusalem. So this king of the north, I'll call him, that's coming with a 200 million man army, is coming rapidly, and the warning comes out from north of Jerusalem in the area of Dan and Ephraim. The clarion call to get out of the land. Get out of, not out of the land, but out of the city. Okay. Jeremiah 4:16. Warn the nations that he is coming. Announce to Jerusalem. Besiegers come from a distant land. They shout against the cities of Judah. Like keepers of a field are they against her all around. Because she has rebelled against me, declares Yahweh. Now, a few minutes ago, you remember the prophet was talking about Yahweh deceiving people. What does Yahweh just say here? Because they rebelled against me. You see, he didn't deceive anybody. They deceived themselves. That is the product of sin, is we deceive ourselves into thinking that it's okay. We think that sin is pleasure for a day. We think there's nothing wrong with it. And a lot of people are of this opinion. Well, all I got to do is run to him, just ask him to forgive me. So I can sin now and go ask him for forgiveness. I can go to the Catholic Church and have my time of confession and pay the priest there to forgive me of my sin, and everything will be just okay. Well, that priest in that church can't do one solitary thing for you, and he cannot forgive you of in one single sin, because he's not your judge. Keepers, shamar, shin, mim, resh, a close watching of something for guarding or protecting. Shepherds built corrals of briars to protect the flocks at night. Rebelled. Look at the meaning of rebelled. Marah. Anybody give me another meaning for marah?
Bitter waters.
Okay. Bitter or rebellious. Marah. The enemy has surrounded Jerusalem like a briar patch enveloping the city. When Israel rebels against Yahweh, his protection is lifted. This is what I said earlier. When you rebel against him, you take away the covering of protection from yourself. And you have nobody but to blame but Y-O-U. Right? Jeremiah 4:18. Your ways and your deeds have brought this upon you. This is your doom, and it is bitter. It has reached your very heart. It is marah. It is bitter. Ways. Here we talk again, direct. We've talked about this many times and defined it. A course of life. The way is a course of life. Now, is there more than one way?
Sure.
Sure. Deeds. Ma'al. Ma'al. Mem ayin lamed lamed. Works. What do you do? A course of life outside of the Torah is what he's talking about in that verse. Man choosing his own way, his own course of life, a way that seems right. Works of the flesh instead of works of the Spirit. This is what he's speaking of. Verse 19. My anguish, I writhe in pain. Oh, the walls of my heart is beating wildly. I cannot keep silent, for I hear the sound of the trumpet, the alarm of war. Crash follows hard on crash. The whole land is laid waste. Suddenly my tents are laid waste, my curtains in a moment. How long must I see the standard and hear the sound of the trumpet? For my people are foolish. They know me not. They are stupid children. They have no understanding. They are wise in doing evil, but how to do good they know not. That hurts to know that that's the way Yahweh sees unrepentant Israel and those walking outside of the Torah. He says they're foolish. Evil. Evil. Aleph, Vav, Yod, Lamet. One without wisdom. So he's saying there that they are one without wisdom when he says, for my people are foolish. They don't have wisdom. The fear of Yahweh is the beginning of wisdom. Psalm 111, verse 10. All those who practice it have good understanding. His praise endures forever. So what is wisdom coming from? The fear of Yahweh. So when he says that they were foolish, what does it mean?
They had no fear.
They had no fear of Yahweh. The lack of a fear of Yahweh renders one to be without wisdom. It is a sure sign that the person does not know Him. They do not know Yahweh. What would you think if Yahweh said that you were silly? Well, He did. Let's look. When He said you're stupid, the Hebrew word there is sakal. Islamic, kaf, and alamic meaning silly. Because you're silly. How you and I choose to live is up to us. How many people agree with that?
True.
Romans 8:5. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. So who makes that choice there? You and I. We choose whether we're going to live by the Spirit or by the flesh. Romans 8:6, to set the mind on the flesh is death. But to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. We make that choice. Jeremiah 4:23. I looked on the earth, and behold, it was without form and void, and to the heavens, and they had no light. Look at that again. How are we doing on time? Okay. I looked on the earth, and behold, it was without form and void, and to the heavens, and they had no light. He's really telling you and I something here. Let's break this down and look. Form is the Hebrew word tohu. A barren place, a wasteland, worthless. Tohu, remember that? Void, bohu. Empty, void. Seeing the earth as it was in Bereshit, chapter 1, verse 1. He is telling you and me, when the 200 million man army descends upon Jerusalem, that the heaven and the earth is going to be as it was when He first began the creation process. How do we know that? Let's look. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, verse 2, and verse 3, we see this in the Hebrew up here. That's the way it is in the Hebrew. So let's look and let's transliterate that. If I look at Genesis 1:1, in the English it says, in the beginning Elohim created the heavens and the earth. In the Hebrew it says, Reshit bara Elohim et shamayim et aretz. Now let's continue to look. So He's talking about the heaven and the earth, just as it was in creation. In verse 2 it says, the earth was without form and void. Isn't that what He just said as I was reading from Yirmiyahu? Okay. The earth was without form and void. It was tohu and bohu, and darkness was over the face of the deep, and the Spirit of Elohim was hovering over the face of the waters. Reshit bara Elohim et shamayim et haaretz. That's the first one. Etz hayah tohu chasek al panim tehom ruach Elohim rachah al panim mayim. So do you see there? He's talking about it being without form and void. Looking at verse 3 in the English. Oh, I didn't finish it. Amar Elohim hayah or hayah or. And then verse 3. And Elohim said, let there be light, and there was light. That's that one. Verse 4. It says in the English, and Elohim saw the light was good, and Elohim separated the light from the darkness. In Hebrew, you read it, Ra'ah Elohim eth, or ki tov, badal Elohim bain, or bain chasek. So He just told us in Jeremiah, chapter 4, the exact same thing He told us in Bereshit, chapter 1, verse 1, 2, 3. Do you see here the end from the beginning? The heavens and the earth will be as they were in the beginning, without form, void, and without light. Verse 24 of Jeremiah 4. I looked on the mountains, and behold, they were quaking. All the hills moved to and fro. I looked, and behold, there was no man. Listen carefully. There was no man. And all the birds of the air had fled. I looked, and behold, the fruitful land was a desert. And all its cities were laid in ruins before Yahweh, before his fierce anger. For thus says Yahweh, the whole land shall be a desolation, yet I will not make a full end. Full end, kalah, a completion, a consummation, or a riddance. In other words, I'm not going to get rid of everything. So what is he going to do? Now we have the earth as it was in Bereshit 1, where it's without form, it's void, and there's no light, and we don't see any birds, and we don't see any people, and things like that. But he says, I'm not going to make it a riddance. I'm not going to get rid of everything. I'm not going to destroy everything. So what is he going to do with the heavens and the earth?
It's
going to be a new heaven and a new earth. Right? Keep in mind there will always be a remnant. How do I know that? I just thought that up, didn't I? No, I didn't think that up. Isaiah 10:20. In that day, the day we're just talking about, the remnant of Israel and the survivors of the house of Jacob will no longer lean on him who struck them, but will lean on Yahweh, the Holy One of Israel, in Emeth, truth. A remnant will return, the remnant of Jacob, to the mighty Elohim. For though your people Israel be as the sands of the sea, only a remnant of them will return. Destruction is decreed, overflowing with righteousness. So most of them are going to be gone, but there will be a remnant. Zechariah 8:12. For there shall be a sowing of peace, the vine shall give its fruit, and the ground shall give its produce, and the heavens shall give their dew, and I will cause the remnant of this people to possess all of these things. So things are going to be restored. It's called the restoration. Everything is going to become like new. A new heaven. A new earth. Not really new, but renewed. A renewed heaven and a renewed earth. Jeremiah 4:28. For this the earth shall mourn and the heavens above be dark. For I have spoken, I have purposed, I have not relented, nor will I turn back. He's not going to turn back, so it behooves you and me to know what's going to transpire and how to live out during those difficult times, how to live and stay alive and do what he says do. Matthew 24:29 says, immediately after the tribulation, for all you people out there who believe in a rapture, please listen. Immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light and the stars fall from heaven and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. At the noise of the horseman and the archer, every city takes to flight. They enter the thickets. They climb among the rocks. All the cities are forsaken, and no man dwells in them. So when Yahweh said a few verses earlier, no man was seen, didn't mean they weren't there. It means they're hiding. It means they're obeying him and getting out of the city and doing what he told them to do. And that's good advice for you and me. Verse 30, and you, O desolate one, what do you mean that you dress in scarlet, that you adorn yourself with ornaments of gold, that you, your eyes with paint? In vain you beautify yourself, your lovers despise you, they seek your life. For I heard a cry as of a woman in labor, anguish as one giving birth to her first child, the cry of the daughter of Zion, gasping for breath. Stretching out her hands, woe is me, I am fainting before murderers. The good news is this. Don't ever like to end a Torah portion on a bad note, right? Out of all of this, the good news is this. In Mark chapter 13, beginning verse 24. But in those days, after the tribulation, The sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from the heaven, and powers in the heavens will be shaken. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. And then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens. So when is he going to rapture his people? After the tribulation. During the end gathering, when he gathers them from the four corners of the earth, from the four winds, if you will. It won't be long now. Endure to the end.
Hallelujah.
Shalom Aleichem.